My name is Elizabeth Ho. I'm director of the Bob Hawke Prime Ministerial Centre here at the University of South Australia. And it gives me enormous pleasure to welcome you all, in particular members of the National Asylum Summit who meet here tomorrow. But this lecture is a very important one to commence proceedings, and we have opened it to the public, and we are indeed delighted with your patronage of the lecture. It's good to see so many of you here. We're going to hear tonight from Professor Ranjana Khanna, who will speak on Asylum Reconsidered, on the right to sleep, perchance to dream. And that perhaps gives you a small indication that she is philosophically inclined. She will be fully introduced shortly, so I will say no more. However, we always begin by recognising Kaurna culture, connection with country, and tonight we're very honoured to have our Kaurna elder, a fellow of this university, Uncle Lewis O'Brien, to give us welcome to country. Thank you, Lewis.
Marawichanga, Kaurna Mia and I Wangani, Mani Tapundagani Atana. Naibirako, Mankalankala, Tandanya, Mianaku. Nature Yungandalia, Nature Yakanandalia, Padne Adlu Wadu. On behalf of the Kaurna people, I welcome you all to Kaurna country, and I do this ambassador of the Adelaide Plains people. My brothers, my sisters, let's walk together in harmony. Natalia.
Uncle Lewis taught me a lot about the land that we are sitting on now. And in our gallery, we recognise Kaurna culture, we recognise Yerra, two-way thinking, which distinguishes Kaurna education, and we recognise the place of the red kangaroo dreaming. And we thank Uncle Lewis, Kaurna people past and present, for the opportunity to meet here tonight. Many of you will know about the Hawke Centre. We have over 6,000 followers, which is a wonderful thing. And we offer a year-long program which engages the community in ideas and solutions for a 21st century. This topic tonight is one that is very important to the Hawke Centre and to everybody in this room. We have just celebrated Refugee Week, and we have a wonderful youth poster exhibition where primary age through to tertiary have celebrated the business of welcoming and recognising the plight of refugees. So this, as I said, is a very fitting addition to our Refugee Week program. We are particularly pleased to be co-presenting this event with the Hawke Research Institute, which focuses on research agendas that reflect, in particular, identity. And again, you will see the connection. We are recording the session tonight. A podcast will be available as usual, and we will place that on our website. We encourage you to bring this to the attention of people who couldn't be here physically tonight. This is the wonderful effect of access through our website is a joy to us all. We would be very pleased if you would keep your phone switched to silent. And at 7 o'clock tonight, no doubt, there will be some distractions, but we would ask if you could keep those distractions to a minimum, that would be appreciated. Our question policy is very simple. Being a centre for democracy, we like to encourage as many questions as possible. So we ask that you avoid very long statements so we can invite as many people as possible to ask questions. If you have to leave early, if you can leave by the upper section, you can go out through the middle section of the auditorium, through the gallery. That means that our speaker doesn't get interrupted. So if you have to leave early, we would appreciate your assistance there. We've had a huge response to tonight. There are many distinguished people in this audience, too many to note in person. I do, however, want to record an apology. It's an apology from Mr. Hugh Van Ley, the Lieutenant Governor of South Australia, who is also the Chair of the South Australian Multicultural and Ethnic Affairs Commission. He was hoping to be here tonight, but has had to withdraw. The topic is one of great interest to him. When he arrived in Australia by boat from Vietnam, a couple of Aussies in a small boat nearby called out, "Welcome to Australia, mate!" And that was his beginning in Australia. Things have somewhat changed since then, but he remains a great statesman, in a sense, for the issue of migration and settlement. I'd now like to invite the director of the Hawke Research Institute, Dr. Anthony Elliott, to formally introduce our speaker. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Elizabeth. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, it's now my great pleasure to introduce tonight's speaker and to preside over the questions and discussion that will follow tonight's public lecture. As director of the Hawke Research Institute, I'm really delighted that we're able to present tonight's public lecture, a lecture which, as Elizabeth has just mentioned, also launches the 2013 National Asylum Summit, which will be held here at the University of South Australia tomorrow with invited participants both nationally and internationally. Very briefly, I just want to also thank our partners and co-sponsors for this event, the Academy of the Social Sciences in Australia, and of course the Hawke Centre at UniSA. But on to tonight's speaker. Ranjana Khanna is Margaret Taylor Smith, Director of Women's Studies and Professor of English, Women's Studies and Literature at Duke University in the United States. Internationally hailed for her interdisciplinary research in literary theory, she's made really important contributions to the fields of postcolonial studies, to literature, to feminist theory, and philosophy. She's the author of, amongst other books, Dark Continents, Psychoanalysis and Colonialism, and more recently, Algeria Cuts, Women and Representation, 1830 to the Present. As one noted American critic has written of Professor Khanna's theoretical research, and I quote, "Pursuing the implication of representational disruption for an ethics and a practice of transnational feminism, Khanna meticulously resists disciplinary strictures and the predictable conclusions that they yield." Professor Khanna has received numerous honours and distinctions. Among others, she's held a Radcliffe Institute Fellowship, Ford Foundation Fellowships, she's been a Rockefeller Foundation Fellow in the Humanities, and also Erasmus Exchange Scholar at the University of Paris 7. Her forthcoming book is Asylum, the Concept and the Practice, and the title of her lecture this evening is Asylum Reconsidered, On the Right to Sleep, Perchance to Dream. I'd ask you all now to please join with me in giving a very warm welcome to Ranjana Khanna.
So thank you very much indeed for inviting me here. I want to thank in particular Anthony Elliott, Jennifer Rutherford and Phoebe Smith from the Hawke Research Institute, and Elizabeth Ho and Louise Cornell at the Hawke Centre for the invitation to be here and the hospitality you have shown already. Thank you also all to you for coming out on this lovely evening. Also, I'd like to thank the Academy of the Social Sciences in Australia. So this talk is precisely interdisciplinary. I think that you have a sense from Anthony that that the work that I do does cover a lot of different disciplines. So if you feel at some points as if you're a little lost, we will be moving on to a more familiar language pretty soon. But I think that everyone should be fine. So the talk is called Asylum Reconsidered, On the Right to Sleep, Perchance to Dream. Part 1, Insomnia. In 2005, the UK-based chapter of the Red Cross commissioned an art exhibition entitled Insomnia for its Refugee Week. The exhibition took its name from a concept found in the work of philosopher Emmanuel Levinas, who was attempting to understand the relationship between the inside and the outside of hospitality, human interactivity, alterity, and what it is that keeps us awake when, in principle, we desire to sleep. The organizers of the exhibition presented video art, short film, and sound photography and sculptural installations that address spatial relations, whether it was through the use of cinematic space, sculptural occupation of space, or installations where we move through art galleries and get caught in the sometimes unsettling reorganization of space brought about through the curatorial decisions. The works in the 2005 Red Cross exhibit did not overtly represent recognizable images of refugees. Anna Shabani's durational video piece, for example, depicts a bed and then a woman lying in it, sleeping and not sleeping, restless, taking up no space and then lots of space. It is unclear in the video if it is her entirely alone in the bed, though it seems to be, at least physically, as the sheets form their own patterns around her as she moves and occupies space. Hers is the most literal of the renditions of the word insomnia that gave the exhibition its title. So as I've said, the exhibition took its title from the Lithuanian Jewish philosopher Emmanuel Levinas, who first started writing on the topic of insomnia in his book Existence and Existence, which hails from the moment of World War II, which he was a prisoner of war camp, and he wrote between the moments of hard labor in that camp. Insomnia, he wrote, when sleep evades our appeal, manifests, quote, the impossibility of rending the invading, inevitable, and an anonymous rustling of existence, end quote. Insomnia, which holds the subject hostage in sleeplessness, is an attack on the consciousness of a subject and its ability to be unconscious or asleep. Some otherness grips the subject and dissolves it. Insomnia is then an attack on the ego by something beyond the control of that ego. Besides using the language of hostage-taking, Levinas describes insomnia in relation to anonymity and placelessness. The otherness to which one becomes subject in insomnia does not have an identity, and it is not situated, he says, but it has a menacing existence. It is, as Levinas puts it, a dissipation of personages. So why insomnia for an exhibition in Refugee Week, or indeed for a talk on the topic of asylum? And why this title that references Hamlet's famous soliloquy, to be or not to be? What is the right and the promise of sleep? For Levinas, sleep is a suspension of physical and psychic activity. He writes, if you can't read it, don't worry, I'm going to read it out. The summoning of sleep occurs in the act of lying down. To lie down is exactly to limit existence to a place, to position. A place is not an indifference somewhere, but a base, a condition. Of course, we ordinarily understand our localization as that of a body situated just anywhere. That is because the positive relationship with a place, which we maintain in sleep, is masked by our relations with things. Then only the concrete determinations of the surroundings, of the setting, and the ties of habit and of history give an individual character to a place which has become our home, le chez soi in French, our hometown, our homeland, the world. When detached from its atmosphere, localization is generally taken to be presence in an abstract extension, like that of a star in the infinity of space. Sleep reestablishes a relationship with a place qua base, he writes. In lying down, in curling up in a corner to sleep, we abandon ourselves to a place qua base. It becomes our refuge. Then all our work of being consists in resting. Sleep is like entering into contact with the protective forces of a place. To seek after sleep is to gropingly seek after that contact. When one wakes up, one finds oneself shut up in one's immobility, like an egg in its shell. This surrender to a base, which also offers refuge, constitutes sleep, in which being, without being destroyed, is suspended. Okay, it doesn't get more tricky than that. Okay. Sleep, for Levinas, is emblematic of the safety and security of a place of refuge we understand as home. The centrality of being linked to place and linked to a place one begins to understand as home and as refuge presents an idea of the solidity of the subject that is constituted through an idea of belonging. For Levinas, there is no consciousness, then, without attachment to a place or refuge where we can first have consciousness and then, in repose, have sleep. Levinas resists this idea of belonging, however, the idea of belonging linked to being as the foundational ontological basis of philosophy. He seeks rather to put in the place of ontology, or a theory of being, a model of ethics understood as a relation to otherness, or a relation of hospitality. In other words, the modern form of being and subjecthood is a problem for him because it does not acknowledge adequately the manner in which it assumes the importance of belonging to a place. Insomnia, for him, becomes one way of understanding this restlessness in relation to something other than being that imposes itself on the subject, undoing it and taking it hostage. Rather than acquiring self-same consolidation of conscious being through refuge, then, Levinas provides a model for thinking relationally, less through an idea of homeland than through one of hostage formation or occupation by the unknown. In the case of insomnia, this occupation is a restlessness that seems to come from elsewhere. It cannot be assimilated into consciousness or the suspension of consciousness, i.e. sleep. So if we accept Levinas's reading, the right to sleep, that is the right to refuge, to a base, to a place, to home, homeland, or to a global or astral location from which one may dream, becomes trouble. It coincides with the right to consciousness or thought that has a location, at least as a point of departure, and the tight connection between being and belonging and property, as we will come to see, in the modern period, is one of the obstacles to hospitality. Insomnia precisely disrupts consciousness, subjectivity, and home by an unrecognizable and anonymous intrusion that may indeed manifest itself as emotion, delirium, madness, or the absence of a master in control of consciousness. There is, of course, in literary terms, a long history of insomniacs whose madness or whose lack of self-mastery in the face of such effective disruption has led to insight. They are both writers like Marcel Proust or Kafka, if we're thinking of the modern period, or literary characters like Hamlet, or the allegedly mad, domestically incarcerated wife in Charlotte Perkins Gilman's The Yellow Wallpaper, or from 1001 Nights, Scheherazade, her sister Dinarzade, and King Sharia, who collectively keep the virgins of the kingdom alive through insomniac storytelling and listening. For psychoanalysis, insomnia is a symptom usually associated with depression, trauma, or the forms of manic behavior one may see in a melancholic. All these symptoms are of the taking hostage of the subject by otherness, such that consciousness cannot absorb or assimilate that otherness into itself. Part 2, hospitality. Hospitality, or the response to the stranger, is a concept that has many mythical instantiations in different cultural contexts. Famously, Zeus carries the epithet Xenios, the protector of strangers. The ancient Greek laws of hospitality demanded certain appropriate gestures in relation to hospitality on the part of the guest and on the part of the host. To violate those laws was not a rudeness or a mishap, but it was a religious transgression that the gods would punish. We see the consequences in Homer's Odyssey for the transgressions of hospitality, which may involve, as they do in the case of those who violate the hospitality given at Odysseus's home, for example, fleeing the house, raping the maids, or courting the wife. Odysseus, calling those violators dogs, kills them, and within the logic of the text is quite just justified in doing so. The hospitality provided to those of the same class, however, made one vulnerable to such violations, and particularly, as many have pointed out, made women vulnerable as appendages of the host. Such ancient rites to hospitality form a framework historically for the manner in which asylum is conceived in international law. As we know, the first theorists of international law were philosophers and jurists. As Vittoria, in the early 16th century, developed a theory of the natural right to travel, reside, trade, use common property, and accept expulsion from the land, he also protected, in principle, indigenous right to own property, expel someone from the land, and not accept mistreatment from foreign visitors. As he understood those as natural rights, he, however, failed to show how they could be implemented in laws. They were moral demands and obligations rather than legal practices, and even as they in principle protected the rights of the foreigner or the non-citizen, they did not provide any legal or institutional means for demanding or protecting those rights. They also naturalized an idea of belonging to land through property. Scholars of early international law, like Gideon Baker, Georg Kavala, Anthony Angi, and Ileana Porras, further elaborate on the manner in which jurist philosophers like Grotius in the early 17th century sought to justify morally the exploits of Dutch colonialism through the natural right to hospitality and trade. By the time we reach the writings of Immanuel Kant in his essay To Perpetual Peace, a philosophical sketch from 1795, the term cosmopolitan was invoked to temper the sovereign power of states on the one hand and support European colonial changing market economy on the other. This most well-known treatise on hospitality across borders articulated them within the contradictory terms thrown up by hospitality, the international command to perform it, and the local sovereignties that protected their right to dismiss or accept the stranger at the gate. In the place of the moral structure of natural right, Kant inserted a notion of cosmopolitan right that guided principles for the right to travel, trade, and reside temporarily or permanently in a foreign state, the right to expel and the right to self-governance. Fundamentally, this right of movement and commerce that he found to be so important would be the backbone of the constitution of laws of peace, a league of peace that he imagined ideally, of ideas of friends and enemies, theorized at least since 1650 by Richard Zauch on the jus intergentes, because as Kant wrote, quote, the spirit of trade cannot coexist with war. We need laws of hospitality then. In other words, the notion of belonging and movement across borders was linked to property and trade. The movement of capital and the ideas of the sovereign self also emerged in conjunction with these. I have elaborated on this trajectory of the philosophies of hospitality in international law in order to situate Levinas in a line of theorists of hospitality who have guided principles on, for example, the right of a foreigner to reside or to be expelled from a site, and to place this discussion in the context of the history and development of international trade and European colonial venture. Even as Levinas sees the trajectory of his own thought in terms of the history of Talmudic philosophy that stands in contrast to what he sees as the Christianized forms of Western philosophy that assume a notion of the subject that is produced through Eurocentric dominance, we can see that his radical understanding of hospitality still nonetheless highlights the antinomies between natural and cosmopolitan law. Levinas's notion of an ethics as hospitality towards another stands in contrast to Kantian ideas of ethics and the sovereign subject. The subject, as we have seen in Levinas's description of insomnia, is by definition welcoming of the other, opening itself to occupation by the other. This opening to the other is an opening to risk, but it is also, if we follow the logic of sleeplessness, uprooting oneself from an idea of being linked to place, home, property, or even world. In Jacques Derrida's reading of Levinas's ethics and the subject, we see this idea of hospitality brought to bear on the contemporary situation of the, quote, persecution of all these hostages, foreigners with or without papers, the exiles, the refugees, those without countries, without state, displaced persons, or populations. For Derrida, Levinas's thinking concerning hospitality as a dissolution of the subject, as a being in place, leads the way to, quote, another international right, another politics of borders, another humanitarian politics, even perhaps an ahumanitarian engagement, which would actually take place beyond the interest of nation states. End quote. If the philosophers of hospitality and international law sought to protect state interests, Derrida looked to find in Levinas an alternative to the domestic and propertied sleeping sovereign subject. In so doing, we see Levinas as a philosopher of ethics as hospitality, with all the risks that go along with that. The subject in dissolution is always of the other. It is the other who demands of the host, who occupies the host. In Derrida's funerary speech for Levinas, later published as Adieu to Levinas, he writes that, quote, if the at-home with oneself of the dwelling is an at-home with oneself as in a land of asylum or refuge, this would mean that the inhabitant dwells there also as a refugee or an exile, a guest and not a proprietor. End quote. In a play called La Ronde de Nuit, or Night Patrol, performed by the traveling theatre company Aftab from Afghanistan, and created in collaboration with the experimental Ariane Mushkin at the Théâtre du Soleil just outside Paris, we're presented with a theatrical space as a set, the caretaker of a theatre, which is an old, fragile structure, shows a man around from Afghanistan. The theatre, she tells us, the caretaker tells us, contains an archive of all that has occurred there. Both the man and the police who come by to do night patrols of the building guard and care for that archive. The caretaker has already told us of the temporary residents of the theatre who make appearances, the prostitutes from across the street, the woman who has nowhere to live, the tramp who comes to use the bathroom. Voices from afar also occupy that space in the theatre through Skype connectivity, which brings the world into this unofficial archive of temporary residents. As the night moves on, the man, who is first shown around, receives a phone call from a friend whom he discourages from visiting him. The friend nonetheless turns up, and then many more come, men and women. As they set up sleeping mats on the floor, each tries to sleep, perchance to dream. Yet each has troubled, unrestful sleep, frightening dreams of the violence from which they have escaped and sought temporary refuge in this temporary residence. They wake from their dreams, are restless insomniacs, traumatized, and unable or unwilling to narrativize and give a name, a structure, or an identity to their troubles. They cannot assimilate into a consciousness on the one hand, or to repose on the other. The police outside do their patrols, as do the prostitutes that work in that area, until the weather becomes frigid and becomes the great equalizer where all seek refuge in the theater space. The theater becomes the site of non-location or non-permanence, of an archive of people passing through. In other words, like Levinas's insomniac, who neither has nor makes claims to place or property where she can sleep, the host is as much a guest as is the other who is welcomed. The calm sleep of belonging, then, is not available to the restless figure who remains ghost, guest and host, temporary residents passing through the planet as they welcome each other through an ethical opening. Part 3, Asylum. So what might be the implication of such artworks for asylum, like the play or the video piece you saw? What does the term asylum mean in relation to hospitality? Asylum as a space is a site of sanctuary, offering apparently, classically, unconditional hospitality, even though determined by ecclesiastical, divine, and sometimes royal parameters. The term designates, too, an institution and building for the mentally unstable, or those labeled thus. And perhaps more importantly for us this evening, asylum is the right of a state to grant refugee status, residency, or citizenship to a persecuted foreigner, the right neither to deport nor to extradite. What kind of a concept is it? Religious, medical, spatial, political, juridical, local, global, androcentric or anthropomorphic, philosophical, or anti-philosophical? And if the latter, is it a concept at all? Extending insights concerning one form of asylum's institutional setting, like the mental asylum, to its most expansive version, the nation, highlights the manner in which asylums, including nations, are bound not only by borders, but also by strict rules. The space of asylum suggests the rights of institutions over living bodies, rather than the rights of citizens emerging into different spaces. Asylum, through figures of sovereignty and subjectivity, highlights the forms through which the sovereign intervenes in lives to formulate concepts of the human, the valuable, the propertied, the citizen, the subject, and indeed the disposable. Today, holding facilities and prisons like the mental asylums of the 19th century restructure and capitalize upon the notion of safe space and alter received norms concerning the treatment of difference, the practice of hospitality, and the regulation of labor. Feminist scholarship has demonstrated the differential violence women encountered in mental asylums through the treatment of hysteria and the incarceration of non-compliant women by fathers, brothers, sons, doctors, and also, of course, female family members also. So now, while my conceptualization of asylum goes back to some foundational texts of asylum and sovereignty in the Western classical tradition, like Livy and Hobbes, for example, my focus is really in the modern period. If the post-World War II period highlights the paradoxical nature of the human through the refugee, what Hannah Arendt referred to as the most symptomatic of all figures, it is because a shift is marked in relations among states and humans internationally. If political asylum was a predominantly Cold War phenomenon, It also marks the period when the term asylum for institutions of the insane decreases dramatically, with shifts in psychiatric practice towards more drug-based treatments. During the 1980s, many state asylums were closed down in many countries, very notably in the US and Great Britain. The reforms from the 1950s, the anti-psychiatry movements, the so-called anti-psychiatry movements, had reached their logical conclusion in the expulsion of inmates, who were then often incarcerated in prisons or made homeless, thereby creating a body of wandering vagrants or internal refugees, internally displaced peoples, indeed. Who was being protected and from whom in these asylums until that point? Conceptual links among the sites designated by the term asylum, or indeed common sociological characteristics emerging in relation to that term, caused Irving Goffman, referring to a variety of spaces, including prisons, army training camps, naval vessels, boarding schools, monasteries, and nursing homes, to call these closed worlds total institutions. They all had resembling characteristics of a type similar to St. Elizabeth's Asylum, the National Asylum for the Insane, in Washington, D.C., on which he based his research. But valuable though this analysis is, it understands a concept only as a metaphor, and ultimately it seeks to think through analogy and substitution. At its broadest, asylum is an opening of one to another. Even when it is a spatial term, as in a mental asylum, it carries the notion of an inviolable site, a viable site that is retained from protection within a sanctuary and a refuge from violence. Etymologically, the word, given architectural parameters, becomes a place without condition. It is sacred, thus providing forgiveness for minor crimes, and non-xenophobic, classically, thus providing a safe place for foreigners. Architecturally, it may be limited to be a part of a temple setting in the Roman context, but the requirement of peace remains. In the Greek, as asoulon, as Fustel de Coulanges informs us, means exempt from seizure or pillage. The etymological roots of this remind us of the form of right that asylum is. Article 14 of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights states that, one, everyone has the right to seek and to enjoy in other countries asylum from persecution, and two, this right may not be invoked in the case of prosecutions genuinely arising from non-political crimes or acts contrary to the purposes and principles of the United Nations. Article 14 of the 1948 Declaration is the only article that is immediately qualified in the way. There is no human right to asylum as such, only the right to seek asylum and to enjoy it if it is granted. It will be considered only if the state considers endangerment to be caused by a form of political persecution. In granting the right of asylum, the state is acting at its most sovereign level. If we understand sovereignty in its Hobbesian sense as the unaccountable right to decide whether someone lives or dies, the state decides whether to let live or make die, and it has affirmed its right to make an exception in its decision not to extradite the asylum seeker. The state's right of asylum presents its sovereignty in decisionism, and through this incarnates its political nature when it establishes its jurisdiction over people. It is indeed paradoxical that asylum has been considered such a worthy form of protection for the most vulnerable and insecure, that is, of stateless peoples of the world, whether refugees or displaced persons. It is true that refugee law can put pressure on states to the extent that they can be required to not expel a persecuted person according to the laws of non-refoulement, municipal rights, and non-extradition. This instantiation of sovereign decisionism, however, even within liberal nation states, has an afterlife within the nation state itself. Hannah Arendt, again in the middle of last century, reminds us of the way in which the stateless person is the figure who we all have the potential to be in the modern nation state. She writes, quote, "Theoretically, in the sphere of international law, it has always been true that sovereignty is nowhere more absolute than in matters of emigration, naturalization, nationality, and expulsion. But one should bear in mind that there was hardly a country left on the continent that did not pass between the two wars some new legislation which, even if it did not use this right extensively, was always phrased to allow for getting rid of a great number of its inhabitants at any opportune moment." End quote. In other words, once we acknowledge the sovereignty of the state as the decider about life and death to those trying to enter, we see also that the population that thinks they belong through the instruments of social contract, property, citizenship, and the documented proper name are also vulnerable. The idea of the healthy, untraumatized, propertied, rights-bearing citizen that protects passionately their homeland and underscores their sense of belonging buys into a narrative of protection that is more fragile than one might assume. Those who have been until recently excluded from rights of full citizenship may bear the scars of such vulnerability, as did the mythical victims of hospitality and belonging to what might be called the human family, to use the language of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, like Locke's daughters, the Sabine women, or Antigone. Having failed to stop the struggle between men for sovereignty over the state, Antigone protests in the only way she can, first through an act of defiance against her uncle Creon by mourning the body of her brother who had not been allowed state burial rights, and then through to suicide, which in many ways is the only way to thwart the sovereign Creon's control over her life and death. Like the Sabine women, Antigone is destined to live with the knowledge of her violent inception that will leave her perpetually melancholic. The restless rejection of the narrative of being and belonging in favor of not belonging to this corrupt system of sovereignty, in which it becomes clear that woman is an anomaly for the state, and like asylum seekers, bears the trace of being less than human in its terms. In saying this, I do not want to pathologize political difference or dispossession, but rather suggest that the narrative of belonging is always a fiction, indeed a legal fiction. Part 4, Boats. This final section begins with a quotation from the Nazi jurist Carl Schmitt, who became an attractive rejected figure by both left and right, writing about changes in the configuration of world systems in his book Land and Sea. "Earth-born, developing on it, man derives not only his horizon from it, but also his poise, his movements, his figure, and his height. That is why he calls Earth the star on which he lives, although, as it is well known, the surface of the planet is 3/4 water and only 1/4 firm land. Even the largest continents are but huge floating islands. And since we found out that our Earth is spherically shaped, we have been speaking quite naturally of the terrestrial sphere or of the terrestrial globe. To imagine a maritime globe would seem strange indeed." End quote. The company, Western Union, was founded in the early 19th century, offering primarily a telegraph service for national and transnational communication. Until very recently, it continued to offer this service, even as it has for some time felt like an outmoded, if not obsolete, form of technology for the transfer of messages around the terrestrial and maritime globe. The sound of the telegraph machine, with its clicks and its pauses, feels like a nostalgic form of sending urgent information from one site to another. For some time, Western Union has been a major resource for the transfer of funds from one site to another for those on the move, for those with no fixed abode, and for those lacking a bank account, for those who should cast no shadow. Unlike people increasingly, of course, capital moves freely around the globe. A bank account usually requires a fixed address with utility bills, which in turn require a bank account. Sometimes they require legal proof of employment, particularly for non-nationals, which may or may not implicate both employer and employed in legal papers for residence and employment. The bank account then, like many of the conveniences of living and movement, relies not only on legal status, but also on an idea of dwelling, and dwelling in the local, even as that notion of the local may have changed historically from region to place to nation, and perhaps beyond through national borders, though national borders are, of course, more porous for some than for others. Recognizing the tenuousness of people's hold on property, perhaps, many banks throughout Africa have joined with Western Union for their money transfers. In spite of the internationalisms of different eras, and even that of modernism with its utopian aspiration and postmodernism with its new technologies and the consequent massive increase in speed of the flow of globalized bodies, information and capital, or with natural change, the national border remains, of course, definitive, and with it comes an affect and ideology of belonging. Western Union lends its name and its logo to the title of Isaac Julian's 2007 video installation, Western Union Small Boats. It is the third in the trilogy of migration, which together with a dance performance became a multimedia performance called Cast No Shadow. This image is from Cast No Shadow. The first two of the video installations, True North and Phantom Afrique, sometimes screened conjointly as Phantom Creole, like Western Union Small Boats, foreground exquisite landscapes and seascapes, but underwrite them with stories of prejudice, exploitation, depletion, or the after effects of globalization. But the stories are less tales of individualized figures of documentary, so much as lyric witnesses of what has become the landscape and seascape, what it has borne witness to. An anthropomorphized figure of woman, appropriately seeming like an animal, like a leopard, prancing around, and I'll come back to this question of leopard in a moment, human, if that includes woman, and technology, cyborg, film camera, and digital apparatus, poses the question of how lyrical aesthetic products present a politics that poses the question of person or human through anthropomorphized gestures. The sea or the land dwell less in this installation, in the individuation of an anthropomorphism as a proper name, so much as in a mobility and transfer that at once announces the inability of that for those named foreign. The lyrical mode of the installation that announces the problem of movement and anthropomorphism is complemented thematically by the banality of actual transport in the Mediterranean passage between North and West Africa and Southern Italy. The lethal, open-topped small boats that roast their passengers with sun exposure and frequently capsize, leaving bodies and boats washed up on the beaches of often exclusive tourist destinations of Southern Europe, the Canary Islands, even sometimes further afield in the Atlantic, extending to the Caribbean. This is what Isaac Julian, talking about the work, characterizes as the clash of two activities. Body bags constructed out of silver foil look at once like complex tanning aids, as their careful folds resemble tinting foil, perhaps more appropriate for the tourists that lie on the other side of the beach, shielded from death and enjoying the sun. The title of Western Union Small Boats itself announces the clash of modes, an ugly juxtaposition of two types of movement of capital that participate in the story of globalization and migration, the flow of disposable income and the flow of disposable people. What Julian calls a migratory aesthetic representing the flow of capital and the movement of bodies, end quote. In this Mediterranean passage, the drama of what Gramsci called the Southern Question, discussing the unification of Italy at that point and the persistence of the impoverished and demonized Southern peasants, is played out with the continent to the south this time, in the moment of globalization and in the moment of limited solidarity and internationalism between Europe and the populations of Africa. There is a witness to this transition to the Southern Question, a witness or a martyr, because it is unclear ultimately whether she is a living person, a witness, a dead specter, a martyr, or an anthropomorphism of the sea, itself possessed by the bodies of many dispossessed. She is often, as here, in silhouette, darkened by cavernous spaces and filmic technology. Isaac Julian refers to her as Adriana, and though she doesn't carry a proper name in the video installation, she does embody its properties of the sea and dark as the source of the name suggests. Quote from Julian, her character is Adriana, whose name comes from the mythical character. The Adriatic Sea is named after her. But she is also a stand-in for a particular survivor of what is referred to as the Sicilian Holocaust, a woman we interviewed while researching the piece. She was one of the sole survivors in a boat tragedy in which more than 90 people were lost to the sea trying to get into Sicily from Libya. There is an indexical aspect to her character for me. She is, of course, very beautiful in a queer sense, writes Julian. Perhaps a more natural or rougher-looking character would suit some folks, but they might be looking for a more documentary approach to the subject, and they should be looking for a TV program for that sort of realism. End quote. She is a character in as much as Adriana is of the sea, and in a sense carries its memory for the waters around Sicily that have witnessed migration from the north for the Adriatic, referenced in the novel Lampedusa's The Leopard and the film Visconti's The Leopard, that gives Western Union small boats its literary and visual history. Western Union Small Boats is a three-pronged installation asking us to consider the challenges of and changes in global communication and flow and the formal as well as the technological differences that come with that. The literal movement of bodies in boats, small open-top boats or tourist cruise ships, the movement of funds and communications signaled by the title, and the history of the visual and literary emerging from this site underscores the change in the culture of Sicily. There remains the trace of Ottoman presence marked in the traces of the Turkish steppes, the north and south unification of Italy, and the complex history of migration in this site, the decline of the aristocracy marked in the changing figures passing through the Sicilian Baroque architecture of the Palazzo Ganji, which is here. Architecture and space have been transformed with migration and sometimes made obsolete. The bodies in these spaces make the architecture and landscape anew as they dance and prance through in carefully choreographed time. All inhabitants are the guests of this land that functions as an archive of migration with its different architectural remnants and preservations. Gesturing towards the history of landscape painting, the film, later transposed to the digital, renders the painterly colors of the land and sea vivid. Contrasting sites in Sicily are rendered coherent through a movement of the camera that juxtaposes interiors with exteriors, which themselves bear witnesses to earlier moments of migration, artistic genealogies, and technologies of histories of rendering the site. This all contrasted with that which we do not usually see from land, or indeed in painting, the life underwater, men swimming as if sharks or dolphins, soaring and twisting through the water, dancing perhaps, and also struggling with the uncertain conclusion that is sea travel for the disposable. A sight rendered possible by digital technology transforms the nostalgic vision of the filmic apparatus through juxtaposition as the digital camera plunges the depths. The contrast allows for a posing of the question concerning the anthropomorphic vision of the European camera that itself confronts the complexities of histories of migration. If Adriana bears witness to all this, she does so in a particularly significant manner. prancing first like the leopard, which is then referenced in the floor of the Palazzo Ganji, and then she is standing, indeed, before the law of the sea, as it were, at the gate which simultaneously allows and disallows access through the presence of a dangling padlock. If for Kafka in his novel The Trial, the door gestured towards the inaccessibility of the law and the cruel arbitrariness of a sovereign's decision-making capacity and the consequences of that, and if for Kutseya, referencing Kafka in the story At the Gate in Elizabeth Costello, the door of the law allowed for a certain insight into the compromised nature of the law as embodied in giving testimony before a board of truth and reconciliation. For Adriana, it seems as if it is a gazing contemplation of the law of the sea, its natural law of ebb and flow, and also its international law of amity lines that questions the efficacy of installing borders through marine law, such that even the sea becomes demarcated and owned, no longer fully part of the commons, and yet seeming, for some, against all odds, to promise the hope of access and safety. The relationship between land and sea is also a contemplation of the relationship between law as dwelling in certain sites on the one hand, and on the other, being more attuned to the movement whereby the sea and sky themselves become demarcated nationally. If following Derrida we understand citation as the referencing of not only a text or an author, but literariness itself, we find the citations of Kafka playing out in relation to the aesthetic as the lyrical posed and played out with the legality of borders and their various technologies. Western Union small boats provides a way of thinking in a global sense of the relation between land and sea, the aesthetic and the material, the lyrical and the legal, and the possibility and threat of imagining hospitality in terms of an inclusion and imagining hospitality in terms of inclusion and exclusion into a human family. Through visual citation of earlier artworks that have contributed to the technologies of migration, Julian's installation witnesses the pressure enacted on European decadence through the emergence of disposable life from the sea and from across the sea to the south. Another history of migration is announced in this context. In this context, it is one of globalization, and through its relation to Visconti's film, we see the same questions of exclusion, inclusion, complicity and compromise, risk and co-optation posed at the moment of Italian reunification. Is Africa to be excluded from the benefits of globalization and become its underside, its foil? The problem of transformismo, the form of inclusion, comes with compromise. Will inclusion exacerbate the discrepancies at either end of the continuum of disposability, prioritizing the decadence of northern life, or will it merely increase southern labor and impoverishment that northern decadence denies and depends on? To think through art from the sea and to think of the sea as a means of understanding art demands an analysis outside a system that works with and against national borders, beyond the existing histories of maritime art as we know it. There is an iconic maritime history, just in closing, of Turner's seascapes that we nonetheless refer to as landscapes, of the turn from his architectural drawing to painting and gestures towards the maritime artists of the 18th century that reached their culmination in romantic maritime art and its sense of the historical. Such art, one could say, emerges in full consciousness of the British Isles as a maritime culture. The shipwreck is always more interesting for Turner than the robust and coherent entity, and the slave ship depicted here is, of course, the ultimate example of this. If the digital camera in Julian's work allows us into another world and aspect of the natural sublime, it is in its underwater plunges, forcing us to see, as it were, what we cannot see in Turner, and yet, as in Turner, showing us that we can never really see all there is to know of a shipwreck, of the legacy of slavery and colonialism, or the systematic impoverishment of those rendered disposable over centuries of international trade and colonial rule. Obviously, the idea of the global and its relative importance has changed dramatically for artists and critics alike alike from colonialism, imperialism, the slave ship and Middle Passage, understood in terms of Liverpool's slave trade and abolitionist movements, imperialist, modernist internationalism, decolonization, and globalization. Julian's installation addresses the idea of the wake of globalization, tracing the boat back through history and hospitality back through international law origins, reveals the colonial and slave trade backdrop to the stories of asylum seekers, to the material stories of asylum seekers. It reveals in the ideology of belonging an ideology of violation. It reveals the centrality and norm of belonging on land as part of a technology rather than a naturalized state. It shows how the underside of an understanding of hospitality that is additive rather than critical. In Julian's work, we see also the host as guest, witnessing the radical historical and diametrical connections among different forms of hospitable, disposable life that make no claim to land, ownership, or indeed the right to repose. I'll stop there.
Khanna, thank you very much. We have now about 10 minutes for questions and comments, as was mentioned earlier, in the spirit of the Hawke bent for democracy, trying to keep these questions very specific and short. The other requirement is, if you're asking a question, if you can just wait until, because we're recording this, for the microphones to actually reach you. So, call for questions and comments. I think Eric is the one. Gentlemen there with the time. Thanks.
Thank you very much for the talk. I was curious if you could say something more about sleeplessness, and especially its link to homelessness. One of the key problems obviously facing the homeless population is the lack of a comfortable bed that many of us enjoy. And so I guess what I'm trying to say is, Is some of the issues you're raising actually also applicable to excluded and marginalized populations within a society and simply not just external to its borders? Thank you.
Yes. Do you want to take more than one, or should we just go with that?
I'll gather some.
Okay, yes. Yes, well, thank you for that question. Yes. Indeed, I am trying to understand here the way in which the concerns that are manifested in relation to asylum seekers are also concerns that one can see manifested in relation to a population that apparently has rights. But there's something else also that I want to do. One is to sort of point out in that the forms of vulnerability that one is subject to, even given citizenship, right? Even given citizenship, given that there is always the possibility of the loss of citizenship and also the possibility of not having the social contract fulfilled when one is a citizen. That is partly what I'm getting at. The other thing, the other side of this that I'm getting at, however, is that while we do need a place to rest, while everyone needs a place to rest, what is interesting to me is the idea of the subject that goes along with that idea of resting. Yes, we need a place to rest, but is rest ever really possible? Right? For the insomniac, rest is not possible, And the insomniac is the one that is trying to open itself to the other.
Sorry, excuse me. Hi. I was just curious as to why you said in relation to the photograph of the lady standing behind the gates looking out to the sea, why you said, the woman, if not human?
Right. Yes. Thank you for that. Yes, I can see that I was a little obscure the way that it came up. What I was trying to gesture towards there is the way in which works of art, as well as legal cases, and this is not my point, this is actually a point made by Barbara Johnson, legal cases and works of lyrical works of art are always trying to suggest an idea of the human. The human isn't a given. It's something that is produced in a case and in lyrical works of art. Now, whether woman has always been human is a question, right? She hasn't always had the kinds of rights that one necessarily associates with the human, neither has she necessarily had the attributes that philosophically have come to define the human. It's a little bit more difficult to see now with woman than it is with something like the child. Jacqueline Barba has written some very interesting works on the way in which the child is such a difficult figure for asylum cases because the child doesn't actually fit into the category of the human that that needs to be in play when trying to understand how to treat asylum seekers. So there are two prongs to what I was saying.
Thank you. I mean, your paper is based upon a critique of state sovereignty, mainly, I think, because state sovereignty is ultimately arbitrary, and therefore the legitimacy of state sovereignty is very difficult to sustain. But I wonder if you have any alternatives to state sovereignty. For example, one of the paradoxes, it seems to me, is that human rights states are typically abusers of human rights, but on the other hand, states are enforcers of human rights. And in the absence of a global government, it seems very difficult to actually conceptualize how the protection of people could be achieved without some form of state sovereignty.
Yes, sure.
My question is, we see globalization is not successful. Global fund to fight poverty is not successful. International norms and standards are falling apart. Nationalism against globalization is growing. With that is crisis, and with that nationalism, fascism is growing. Golden dawn in Greece is very obvious, and in many waters people are drowning. So what from here on? That Geneva Convention of after the Second World War is sufficient, or we need something better, more comprehensive? Thank you.
Well, as I don't have much time, I don't think I can solve all the world's problems. But I hear you, and let me try to address that. Let me just go to the first question first. Yes, I am offering a critique of state sovereignty. You're right, and the talk is in the realm of critique rather than in the realm of solution giving. There are a couple of things I would say about it. One is that, of course, some states are more sovereign than others, and we see the effects of that on populations in those places. It seems to me we see in relation to internally displaced peoples. So state sovereignty. in those sites, I think, is important to understand as diminishing. So it's not clear to me any way that we actually do have state sovereignty everywhere. It is, however, in asylum cases, it is, however, the way in which a decision is being made. What's the alternative to state sovereignty? Well, you know, I don't know. I will say that I don't know. I am working in the level of critique, and I make no apologies for that. But it seems to me that there are more global entities that have been put in place, some of which do some quite important work, and some of which only protect those who can really be involved in those entities in terms of financial markets. So I would say that it would be important to have some more robust and international entities that really did work, that really were hospitable to the demands of disposable life. Globalization, I agree, is not successful entirely, although it is quite successful in some sites within its own terms. There is indeed a rise to fascism, and it seems to me that this is precisely why we need a different kind of model of the subject that moves away from a kind of genocidal logic that is the flip side of identity formation.
Ranjana, sadly we are out of time there. I'm now going to call on Elizabeth Hope to return to the lectern to deliver the vote. Thanks.
We had with us just now Kelly Vincent, member of the Legislative Council, who represents the interests of those with disability in Australia. And Kelly, because of her responsibilities, was unable to get here on time and had to leave early. But it did occur to me, when we had the question to Ranjana about the notion of those seeking asylum within a sovereign state, that Kelly herself has had to stand up many, many times to defend the rights of those who are disabled. In that context of thinking about those who are excluded, I think that Ranjana has given us a series of tableaux in which we can gain ideas and images, where we can put those together in a way that creates a sense of understanding of the plight and the predicament of never being able to rest, which equates to being on the move, stateless, in the sea, unable to predict a future. Very often in Hawke Centre presentations, we are given facts, we are given solutions. Tonight, I think, has been a celebration of ideas, of thinking beneath the obvious. And I'd like to thank Ranjana very much for challenging us to think perhaps more deeply, to plumb the depths of the sea in our minds about what it does mean to be excluded, to be disposable, to be unwanted. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much.